Nursing management of the newborn. Immediately after the birth of a newborn, all parents are faced with the task of learning and understanding as much as possible about caring for this new family member, even if the parents already have other children. In their new or expanded role as parents, they will face many demands and challenges. For most, this is a wonderful, exciting time filled with many discoveries and much information. The period of transition from intrauterine to extrauterine life occurs during the first several hours after birth. During this time, the newborn is undergoing numerous adaptations, many of which are occurring simultaneously. The neonate's temperature, respiration, and cardiovascular dynamics stabilize during this period. Close observation of the newborn's status is essential. The initial newborn assessment is completed in the birthing area to determine whether the newborn is stable enough to stay with the parents or whether resuscitation or other immediate interventions might be necessary. A second assessment is done within the first 2 to 4 hours when the newborn is admitted to the nursery or the labor and delivery room where the parents are. The third assessment is completed before discharge. The purpose of these assessments is to determine the newborn's overall health status, to provide information to the parents about their newborn, and to identify apparent physical abnormalities. During the initial newborn assessment, the caregiver will look for signs that might indicate a problem. These include nasal flaring, chest retractions, grunting on exhalation, labored breathing, generalized cyanosis, abnormal breathing sounds, abnormal respiratory rates, a flaccid body posture, abnormal heart rates, or abnormal newborn size. Apgar scoring was introduced in 1952 by Dr. Virginia Apgar. The Apgar score is used to evaluate a newborn's physical condition at 1 minute and 5 minutes after birth. 5 parameters are assessed with Apgar scoring. A quickly to remember the parameters of Apgar scoring is as follows. A is appearance. P is pulse. G is grimace. This is reflex irritability. A is activity or muscle tone. And R is respiratory. Each parameter is assigned a score ranging from 0 to 2 points. A score of 0 points indicates an absent or poor response. A score of 2 points indicates a normal response. A normal newborn score should be between 8 to 10 points. Length and weight are 2 parameters that new parents are excited to learn about. Length is measured from the head of the newborn to the heel with the newborn unclothed. The expected length range of a full-term newborn is usually 17 to 22 inches. A newborn typically weighs between 5 pounds 8 ounces to 8 pounds 14 ounces. Newborns typically lose approximately 10% of their initial birth weight by 3 to 4 days of age, secondary to loss of meconium, extracellular fluid, and limited food intake. This weight loss is usually regained by the 10th day of life. Newborns can be classified by their birth weight regardless of their gestational age. A low birth weight is considered a newborn weighing less than 5.5 pounds. Very low birth weight is a newborn below 3.5 pounds. An extremely low birth weight would be a newborn weighing less than 2.5 pounds. Heart rate and respiratory rate are assessed immediately after birth with Apgar scoring. Heart and respiratory rates are usually assessed every 30 minutes until stable for 2 hours after birth. Heart rate is obtained by taking an apical pulse for 1 full minute. The newborn's heart rate is usually between 120 to 160 beats per minute. The newborn's respiratory rate is usually between 30 and 60 breaths per minute and is symmetric with chest movement. Once the vital signs are stable, the heart rate and respiratory rates are then checked every 8 hours. Typically, gestational age is determined by using a tool such as the Duvitz-Ballard or New Ballard scoring system. This scoring system provides an objective estimate of gestational age by scoring the specific parameters of physical and neuromuscular maturity. Points are given for each assessment parameter with a low score of -1 or -2 points for extreme immaturity, up to 4 or 5 points for post-maturity. The scores from each section are then added up and correspond to a specific gestational age in weeks. The physical maturity section of the examination is done during the first 2 hours after birth and includes the following: skin texture, lanugo, plantar creases, ears, and eyes. The skin texture typically ranges from sticky and transparent to smooth with varying degrees of peeling and cracking to parchment-like or leathery with significant cracking and wrinkling. Lanugo is the soft downy hair on the newborn's body, which is absent in premature newborns. Lanugo appears with maturity and then disappears again post-maturity. Plantar creases are the creases on the soles of the feet, which range from being absent to covering the entire foot, depending on the maturity. The greater the number of creases, the greater the newborn's maturity. The eyelids can be fused or open, and ear cartilage and stiffness determines the degree of maturity. The greater the amount of ear cartilage with stiffness, the greater the newborn's maturity. 6 activities are evaluated to determine the newborn's degree of maturity: posture, square window, arm recoil, popliteal angle, scarf design, and heel to ear. Posture looks at how the newborn holds his or her extremities in relation to the trunk. The square window assesses how far the newborn's hands can be flexed towards the wrist. The arm recoil considers how far the newborn's arms are able to spring back to a flexed position. Popliteal angle looks at how far the newborn's knees extend. Scarf design explores how far the elbows can be moved across the newborn's chest. An elbow that does not reach midline indicates greater maturity. Heel to ear looks at how close the newborn's feet can be moved towards the ears. Typically, newborns are also classified according to gestational age as follows. A preterm or premature infant would be one born prior to 37 weeks gestation, regardless of birth weight. A term newborn would be considered those born between 38 and 42 weeks gestation. Post-term or post-date infants are those born after the completion of 42 weeks of gestation, and post-mature infants are those born after 42 weeks that demonstrate signs of placental aging. Newborns can also be classified as small, appropriate, or large. Small for gestational age are those having a weight less than the 10th percentile on the standard growth charts, usually below 5.5 pounds. Appropriate for gestational age are infants weighing between the 10th and 90th percentiles. Large for gestational age are those with a weight more than the 90th percentile on the standard growth charts, usually above 9 pounds. Immediately after birth, a newborn is suctioned to remove fluids and mucus from the mouth and the nose. The newborn will also commonly receive 2 ID bracelets, one on the wrist and one on the ankle. The mother receives a matching one, usually on her wrist. The ID bands usually state the name, gender, date, and time of birth, along with an identification number. The same identification number is on the bracelets of all family members. The newborn's footprints might also be taken, using a form that includes the mother's fingerprint, name, date, and time of birth. It is recommended that vitamin K be administered to all newborns soon after birth. The newborn's bowel is sterile, so vitamin K is not produced in the intestine until after microorganisms have been introduced, such as with the first feeding. Usually, it takes about a week for the newborn to produce enough vitamin K to prevent vitamin K deficiency bleeding. All newborns in the United States, whether delivered vaginally or by cesarean birth, must receive an instillation of a prophylactic agent in their eyes within an hour or two after birth. This is mandated in all 50 states to prevent a condition called ophthalmia neonatorum, which can cause neonatal blindness. Ophthalmia neonatorum is a hyperacute purulent conjunctivitis occurring during the first 10 days of life. It is usually contracted during birth when the baby comes in contact with infected vaginal discharge of the mother. Most often, both eyes become swollen and red with purulent discharge. Several medical interventions take place to assist the newborn in maintaining its body temperature. The newborn is dried immediately after birth and wrapped in warm blankets. Stethoscopes and hands are warmed before handling the baby or providing care. Are instructed to avoid placing newborns in drafts or near air vents to prevent heat loss through convection. Also, there's often a delay in the initial bath until the baby's temperature has stabilized. This prevents heat loss through evaporation. It is also recommended to avoid placing cribs near cold outer walls to prevent heat loss through radiation. You might also notice that a cap is placed on the newborn's head after it has thoroughly been dried after birth. In some instances, the newborn might be placed under a temperature-controlled radiant warmer. The vernix caseosa is a thick white substance that protects the skin of the fetus. It is formed by secretions from the fetus's oil glands and is found during the first 2 to 3 days after birth. It does not need to be removed because it will be absorbed into the skin. Molding is the elongated shaping of the fetal skull to accommodate passage through the birth canal. It occurs with vaginal birth from a vertex position in which elongation of the fetal head occurs. It typically resolves within 1 week after birth without intervention. The newborn's neck will appear almost non-existent because it is so short. The neck should move freely in all directions and should be capable of holding the head in a midline position. The newborn should have enough head control to be able to hold it up briefly without support. Newborn reflexes includes the following: the sucking reflex, the Moro reflex, also called the embrace reflex, that occurs when the neonate is startled. There is also the stepping reflex. The baby should make a stepping motion or walking motion, alternating flexion and extension with the soles of their feet. The tonic neck reflex resembles the stance of a fencer and is often called the fencing reflex. The rooting reflex is elicited by stroking the newborn's cheek. The newborn should turn toward the side that was stroked and should begin to make suckling motions. The Babinski reflex is elicited by stroking the lateral sole of a newborn's foot. When this is done, the toes should fan out. The newborn also exhibits two grasp reflexes, the palmar grasp and the plantar grasp. The umbilical cord begins drying within hours after birth and is shriveled and becomes blackened by the second or third day. Within 7 to 10 days, it sloughs off and the umbilicus heals. During this transition, frequent assessment of the area is necessary to detect any bleeding or any signs of infection. Every state requires the use of car seats for infants and children. Because motor vehicle accidents are still the leading cause of unintentional injury and death in children under 5 years of age, National Highway Traffic Safety Administration statistics show that nearly one half of deaths and injuries in infants occurred because they were not properly restrained. Child safety seats, when installed and used properly, can prevent injuries and save lives. Select a car seat that is appropriate for the child's size and weight. Caution caregivers against the placement of car seats on elevated or soft surfaces outside the car to prevent falling. Use the car seat correctly every time the child is in the car. Use rear-facing car seats for most infants up to 2 years of age. Make sure the harness is in the slots at or below the level of the shoulders. Thank you for watching.